So another historic tradition of NIPS that I think is sort of coming even more to the fore and is I think perhaps more important now is to maintain this relationship across NIPS and cognitive science, all these areas about the brain, psychology and things like that. That actually gets harder to do as the community gets larger. And I was really pleased to sort of understand that Volker, who's sort of more traditionally works at Siemens and does some amazing applications, has a great history and methodologies, but has an interest in this area. So he also seemed like a really obvious choice to come and speak to us at DALI. So, and he's going to talk about on possible relationships between episodic memory, semantic memory, and perception.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks for inviting me. That's a great place to be. So I'm with Siemens and also with the University in Munich, and currently I work with Yun Pu Ma, Stefan Bayer, Ian Chong Yang, and previously with Maximilian Nickel, who invented the RESCAL model. I will present Dennis Krompas, Shen Yang, and Christopher Esteban. So here's an outline. I will start with introducing knowledge graphs and learning with knowledge graphs. And then I will discuss how they can be used to model semantic memory, episodic memory, and also discuss a connection to perception. And finally, speculate about relationships to human memory. So why does machine learning should care about knowledge graphs? Machine learning is great in input-output, stimulus-response type of learning, classification, prediction, and so on. But how can machine learning exploit the fact that Obama is ex-president of the United States? So this is this type of knowledge is covered in a field called knowledge representation, and is closely related to relational databases and knowledge graphs. So here's an example. We have a smart agent, and he recognizes you must be ex-president Obama, and then due to his knowledge graph, he knows that he's married to Michelle Obama. And then, of course, we can do induction and conclude that he must be male and white, and okay, one and two is correct. We probably know why. But that's a challenge, how to do machine learning in these knowledge graphs. So knowledge graph is very simple. So on the top left, you see a very simple example. So an entity is a node. So Max and Mary is a node. And likes is a predicate as a directed link. So we are used to maybe Bayesian networks and so on. So you should think of this whole statement as being a random variable and maybe being a node in a Bayesian network. So these two things are, in a way, dual. So on the right side, you see a simple example. Albert Einstein is born in 1879, is born in Ulm. Ulm is in Germany. Germany is a state. Albert Einstein is a physicist, a researcher, and so on. So that's, I think everybody can follow that and can understand that. Because knowledge representation in general is very complicated, difficult to understand for outsiders using a lot of logical formulations. But knowledge graphs are very simple and sufficient for many, many scalable applications. And it's a link between cultures, between maybe machine learning and knowledge representation. And it brings order to things with surprisingly simple constructs. Before I learned about this stuff, I was puzzled about how to model the world and how to bring order into things. And machine learning alone has problems there, but if you link it to knowledge graphs, things become quite simple. And so people have developed larger knowledge graphs. A famous one is DBpedia, which builds on the info boxes in Wikipedia. And on the top right, you see Jago, which was built by the Max Planck Institute for Informatics in Germany. And then on the bottom right, you see the Google knowledge graph. So Google bought a company called Freebase, and they made it really work. So they made it big. So the Google knowledge graph contains 100 billion facts. They solved the quality issue by having hundreds of people working on maintaining the knowledge graph. So the quality is great. And they made it useful. They use it in search, in question answering, and in information extraction from text, for example. So that's, for me, that's an amazing, huge breakthrough in this field. And so it's not just Google. So many companies are now starting to building knowledge graphs. We have an effort here in a funded project. Essentially, it's a supply chain sort of application. So we want to characterize companies where we might want to buy parts from. So what's their price? How big are they? What's the quality? How reliable is it? And then link it to internal data, internal company data. So you can ask questions. Show me all suppliers of optical sensors, or what is the parent company of supplier X, or which sensor suppliers have an order volume larger than 100K euros. So this type of technology is often used in data knowledge integration, which is an amazingly complicated, difficult, impossible task. So knowledge graphs doesn't just solve it, but it's a tool which might be very useful there. It's used in question answering. For example, in Google, then you can build statistics, visualization, trend analysis, and so on, and you can use it as a support for document understanding. And so how about learning with knowledge graphs? So our approach was to take the whole knowledge graph and make it into a tensor. And the idea is you have three things here, subject, predicate, object. Max likes Mary, so you need three indices. Three indices give you a tensor, which is just a generalization of a matrix in our context here. And we put a one if we know that this triple is true, this subject predicate object pairs triple is true. Otherwise, we leave everything zero. So it's huge and sparse. And then we factorize it, and Maximilian Nickel developed this Rescal approach. That's a particular way of doing a factorization. And we obtained a matrix and a core tensor. So in the matrix on the left with this green bar, you see latent representations for this entity. So in this case, I might be Max. So you see a bunch of numbers representing Max. On the right side, you see the same matrix, just transposed. So you see where Mary is represented, and in the middle we have one matrix for each relation type. So to get a prediction of the plausibility of a triple, we just do this vector matrix vector product and get a number out, which is shown in the bottle as this bottom at this as this theta, and the theta we plug into the sigmoid and get a probability out that this triple is true. So after the reconstruction, if a 1, so if a fact wants to become a 0, it might be a mistake in the database. More interestingly, if a 0 wants to become a 1, it might be a fact which can be explained by the patterns the algorithm sees in the data. So we can do this type of inferential reasoning. We consider tensor factorization as a form of representation learning. On the bottom, again, you see Max likes Mary. Max has a latent representation, which is just this vector there on the left. Likes has a latent representation in the middle, and Mary has a latent representation. And then there's a map of these latent representations to a number, to this confidence score. And you can use a core tensor if you like tensors, or you can also plug in a neural network, which other groups have done. So there's a link to representation learning, and important is that every entity has only one latent representation, independent if it's a subject or an object in the relation. And by doing this, we can get propagation of information through this graph. So it's not just a local operation, it also incorporates information which might be several steps away in the graph. And it also scales quite nicely. And we did a lot of benchmark tests, and we're quite happy about the results. But it's another thing to really try a serious application. And this was also done by Google people. So Google Knowledge Vault was a project where they tried to fill automatically the knowledge graph by reading the web, by analyzing texts, tables, whatever they can find. And this fused extractor got an AUC score of 0.927. And then they did also what I just described to predict triples just out of the knowledge graph itself. And the second one, this factorization approach, let's say is close to Rescal. You got a score of 0.882. And on top of that, they learned some simple rules with this path ranking algorithm, which gave a very comparable score. If they combined these two scores or these two methods, the fuse prior was higher, so 0.911, so they learned different things. And then they fused all these different approaches, and the AUC went up to 0.947. Maybe it's a small difference, but if you look at the high confidence triples, it went up from 100 million to 271 million. So we wrote a nice review paper with these guys, or some of these guys, it's also from Google, Murphy and Gabilovich, was a preceding IEEE paper. I think Google, at least at that time, wasn't quite happy enough with the quality, they want 99%. I assume it's still ongoing work at Google. But for us it was a really nice proof that this learning from the graph itself really works. So you can do inferential queries, for example, if you have data about patients, you can ask what disease does Jack likely have. So you get you look at the triples which have a high confidence value there. You can do automatic filling of knowledge graphs like in the Knowledge Vault project. Essentially it's a learning database. It doesn't just work for triples, it can also work with higher order relation types, relationships. You can use it as background information because you extract these latent representations of entities which you can then use in other applications. For example, prediction and decision support. Also, RESCAL works, so the approach I presented, I mean, falls into this whole class of ILP, maybe probabilistic programming, statistical relational models, and people like RESCAL because it's very easy to use. You get results very quickly without having to specify rules or constructs or whatever. So I think that's part of the success. But of course, it's not the complete solution. Not one tool fits all. Factorization is good at patterns with one universal quantifier. So if you like this, you're also like that. But it's bad if you have more than one universal quantifier. For example, if A is married to B, then B is married to A. It's for all A and for all B. So for these type of patterns, you need rules. And in this paper down there, we introduce very simple rules, you know, from social network, like triangle rule and so on. And that improved the model and brought down the rank of the factorization dramatically. So you need typically a combination of things. So let's come to semantic memory, episodic memory, and perception. So semantic memory is a concept from cognition, and it's about facts we know. Like Obama is ex-president of the United States. We don't know where we learned it, we just know it's a fact. Of course, our mathematical assumption is that this knowledge graph model is exactly that, it's a semantic memory. So I just redo it here. You have this index layer with one hot encoding, Max, likes, and Mary. You calculate the latent representations, you have this combination, and you get the likelihood out for this triple to be true. We also like a slightly different formulation or interpretation. It's exactly the same math, it's just a little bit different interpretation. So let's say S and P is given and you want to know O, so Max likes and what does he like. Then you just rewrite the tensor equation in this form, which gives you a predicted latent representation based on subject and predicate, and you form an inner product with the latent representations of the object. So we think that this makes, for example, biologically much more sense because inner products are very easily to do with neural hardware. And you can so nothing special about object, you can do the same thing with the predicate or the subject. So what is an episodic memory? It's facts we remember, like what you had for dinner yesterday. You might not want to remember, but you remember. And you need the notion of, for example, in healthcare, when something happened. No? So what recently was done to the patient. So we simply think, instead of using a three-way semantic tensor, we use a four-way episodic event tensor. So we add one more latent representation here. So one more index for the time, and one more latent representation, which stands for anything that happened at that instant in time. But time should be like very coarse, typically. And it's like a visit of a patient to a doctor or to a clinic. So that would be one time step. What you would think of as an episode. So the whole dinner, not maybe every step yesterday at dinner. So this is how it looks like. We just have one more later representation here, and we can represent that on this date, Jack was diagnosed with diabetes. There's a mathematically fine point here. So in learning, we use a Bernoulli distribution, so everything is nicely and independent. We don't have to care about global normalization. But in querying, we think we want to reproduce triples with high energy or high probability. So we put it into a simulated annealing framework, and the nice thing then is we really get a joint distribution out of subject, predicate, object, and time, so we can manipulate with these four variables as in a four-dimensional space. And we can do marginalization, we can do conditioning. So for example, if we only have this representation of time here, so what happened at that time, then we can predict what's the probability that Jack did something, that he was diagnosed with something, and that he was diagnosed with diabetes. And you can do this all by conditioning and marginalization. And we applied this, in fact, to medical decision support. So the semantic data here would be everything we know about the patient, background information. The episodic data would be what happened to the patient in the last visits. For example, in nephrology, patients come back every couple of months to the clinic and get their blood analyzed and so on. And then we want to find best treatments, best procedures to apply. There are two approaches we are pursuing. One is decision modeling, where we just predict the next action of the physician, the next medication, the next procedure. Another variant is endpoint prediction, where we predict survival of the kidney, for example. And we use a mixture of things, of semantic knowledge graph, episodic knowledge graph, but also LSTM models. And we have data from breast cancer, from Erlangen, from nephrology, from Charité, and age-related macular degeneration from the LMU clinic. So it turns out to be, I think, exactly the cases DeepMind is considering, but I guess these are domains where good data exists in some sense. So. But then, finally, I mean, if you're a cognitive being, everything comes to the senses, so nobody plugs in your knowledge graph, so you have to think about what do you do with sensor information. And our idea is very simple, so we have a deep network, let's say, a multi-layer structure here, from sensory input to this latent representation for time. So we predict it from the sensory input, from the image, for example. And then we have a decoder here which happily produces SPO triples explaining the scene. So this is what we are currently working on. It's a very difficult problem that's not solved. But maybe in general it might be the next thing after simply classification, like there's a cat, there's a dog. No? Where's the cat? What's the cat doing? So I think this is probably where the field is going in some sense. So finally, what's the relationship to human memory, maybe? So this is how a human memory is typically organized. On the right side you see long-term memory and then declarative memory. So that's the stuff you can talk about, no? Like what happened at dinner last night, Obama's president of the United States. And on the bottom you see this division into semantic memory, what do you know, and episodic memory, what do you remember. The other important thing is sensory memory on the top left. So these are short-term buffers of visual impressions, of auditory impressions. And then there's short-term memory, which is part of working memory, and that's really your smartness, your intelligence, supposed to be located, the central executive in your prefrontal cortex. So that makes you human. That's also called memory for interesting reasons. So we found an interesting literature here. It's called hippocampal memory indexing theory, which agrees with part of our model quite nicely. So you have sensory input, like an image or something. Everything goes to the thalamus, at least most of the sensory inputs. And then you have these different layers of processing, the first, second, third, and nth order sensory areas. And the assumption is that they sort of form this latent representation of time. We need to describe this episode. And so simply the higher order, the association areas would be that representation. And then this theory tells us that the things we need to remember because they're emotional, maybe driven by the amygdala or so on. An index is introduced in the hippocampus, and this index simply links to this representation. So for each new thing, to be remembered, a new index is represented. So you can think of it as a neuron, but I will argue against the neuron, or people argue against the neuron. But something like a new index is somehow formed in the hippocampus, and it links to this latent implantation by just copying this activation pattern in the simplest case. Of course, if you want to recall something, you just activate this old index neuron of a week ago or something, and then it restores this pattern here, and then you get the visual impression back of what happened last month, let's say. And then supposedly there's a consolidation process that the memory moves out from the hippocampus to neocortex. And from this model, it would be also very simple. It's simply a retraining of this. So you reactivate the pattern then becomes copied into the neocortex. There's not too much agreement about all these mechanisms, how this is supposed to happen, but that's sort of the current theory, and this transfer supposedly happens during sleep and during non-REM sleep. He might be doing something very important, but only if his eyes are not moving. So have a good sleep, yeah, that's very important. And just to tell you where the hippocampus is located, and there's a lot of detailed substructures. Interestingly, here, this part called dendrite gyrus is the only part in the adult brain where it's known that new neurons are being formed even in the adult brain. So that might hint that new indices are needed, new neurons are formed. The fact is true, but the relationship to the index is not so well known. This is a big issue. The technical solution, what we want to have is something like an index neuron or index unit, which activates this pattern, and this pattern activates. So it goes both ways, it's bidirectional. Interestingly, also our mathematical framework doesn't need a pseudo inverse, it can go both directions by just using this A matrix. But in cognition, I think this is a big open problem. How do you store something quickly, a new resource and its properties? New neurons are only formed in this particular part of the hippocampus. On the right side, maybe this is a little bit more how people look at this. So maybe there's a sensory here, and then you have different layers, and things become more specifically. So if you remember a particular person, in the higher level of processing, it might be quite specific features which were derived, and the lower levels, everything is probably pretty much overlapping. And biologists or cognitive people agree with everything except for this, or would agree with most of the stuff probably, except for this last layer. And then they think, and they still have problems thinking about indices really representing entities. There's this concept of grandmother cells, some people might be familiar with. But there is locality, without any question. Here are two famous experiments. The first one is from Quiroga and co-workers, and they discovered extremely specific neurons in part of the medial temporal lobe. Initially they were called Jennifer Aniston neurons or Halle Berry neurons, and now they're called concept cells. So they fire to anything related to Jennifer Aniston here, even just calling her name or reading an article about her, and they don't respond to anything else. No? So there's this extreme locality. It's a single neuron, but it's a very, very localized place in this part of the brain. Another thing here from Hood and Garland from this group, they mapped semantic concepts onto the brain surface and found very nice topological ordering. And it's semantically, it's not the word, it's like top, is one's top of something and one top of a bikini. So it also speaks to some degree to locality. So locality is not, it's just not clear how to interpret this, I guess. Also, this is a point in perception. This is just a deep neural network with some classification on the left side. So maybe this is the level of some animals, let's say. There's a tiger jumping at me, I should do something. But maybe this is exactly the part where humans are much better, that they really have a semantic understanding of a scene and can describe it in much more detail. For example, here, this is some work from Stanford group, I think, so it's going in this direction. It's still a huge challenge and definitely not solved. No? Person on a motorcycle, person with a helmet, motorcycle has wheel and so on. So I think these are definitely things computer vision people are highly interested in. Then I already mentioned this nice thing about this integration property of these tensor models. And so why not think of semantic memory as simply an integration of the episodic memory? So here we have on this day, Jack was diagnosed with diabetes. If you integrate out this thing here, and technically this just means that we put once here, so essentially all these inputs become active. That means at some time Jack was diagnosed with diabetes. So at least we argue for some time maybe this semantic memory is simply just an integration of episodic memory. At some point probably it becomes more autonomous. We tested this assumption of this integration. You should look at maybe the top left plot here, because here we are really interested in memorizing, not so much in generalization. We want to memorize past facts, and this integration, which is a thread curve, sort of approaches the model where we directly train the semantic model to some degree. I think this is also still ongoing work, but it makes a lot of sense also from a biological perspective. I mean, having a transfer from episodic to semantic memory would be very complicated unless they're almost the same anyway. So I think that supports our model quite nicely. Also, I mean, there are people with some famous people with damages to their hippocampal area, and they lose the ability to form new memories, which of course also completely agrees with our assumption that these indices are formed in the hippocampus, and if no more indices are formed, then you cannot store any more episodic memories in your brain. We also would argue that these later representations are not just useful for memory and inductive inference maybe, but also can be used for all sorts of other applications like prediction planning, and some of these functionalities are associated with working memory. Of course, also if you have a unique representation for an entity in your brain, you get sharing of information between the different tasks, so that can be quite useful. But so you should think of this whole column or complexity of activation. So if Halle Berry is activated here, you know, all these things get activated. And so this whole pattern will be useful for different tasks, which I think makes a lot of sense. No? So this is a full picture. Here's the episodic, the sensory input, here's the thalamus, here's the sensory levels, here's a representation of time, which gets an index neuron here in the hippocampal area, and then this core tensor uses representation for subject and object to make statements about interpretation of a scene. These representations are probably also formed for entities in the hippocampal complex. For example, if you look at this Jennifer Aniston neurons, but they're probably also consolidated in the cortex at some point, neocortex at some point. So these are, let's say, my main hypothesis you might derive from this work. So perception is a decoding of high-level sensor areas and requires later representations for entities, locations, and predicates. There might be a huge increase in complexity in this step in humans. This might be a path to language. So maybe first you understand the scene and then you start describing it. Episodic memory in our model would store information on the subsymbolic level, so simply this latent representation for time would be responsible. In collection of past episodes, the time index is activated, which activates this latent representation, which then gives you the feel and the look of this episode, but also the interpretation of this episode. Learning is applied to set up the whole structure, but if you just have to memorize something, there's not too much learning involved. It's just the forming of a new index and the mapping of the index to the activity pattern, but you don't have to refit all what you've learned before. Our hypothesis would also be that semantic memory is derived from episodic memory by an integration or marginalization step. Eventually, probably the integration is becoming part of the model, so it would be too expensive to always do this integration. Binding by an index node is technically very, very sensible. Biology might have chosen different forms of coding, but then you get this interference problems. Working with Hopfield type networks, and they seem to work now in the sense that if the connectivity is very sparse. They seem to not have all the problems I learned about when I started working with them. And other forms of processing, like executive functions, might also build on the latent representations of entities, locations, predicates, times, and time instances. So in conclusion, I think I'm doing quite okay. Oh, really early. So memory function might be a good starting point for understanding intelligent systems. Now, often we start with a sensory layer and do very fancy deep learning mechanisms to mimic the sensory processing of the in the visual cortex, for example, and then like memory. There are some groups like Google DeepMind working on different approaches to episodic memory, but memory typically comes afterwards. If you start with memory, my proposal or suggestion would be some things are quite clear, or maybe it's a different starting point, a different perspective to look at the same problems, and you get different kind of insights. Maybe a good starting point for working with intelligent systems. So I think there are compelling links to human memory. And the question is always, can technical solutions learn from an understanding of cognitive systems? And the other way around, can cognitive neuroscience get inspired from computational memory models? The first question, I think yes, because for me it gives a good feel for what is possible and what maybe one should try. For example, logical reasoning. Maybe we should first understand how good humans are really at this task, and then also maybe accept the technical limitations of logical reasoning systems. Also, you get a feeling of completeness. So if you go back through a book on cognitive science and you look at all the chapters and all the different things which are going on, from vision to memory to consciousness to reasoning and so on, you get a feel for the different aspects of intelligence, which might be important to eventually derive a really truly intelligent system. And it's really the sum of the parts, plus an amazing ability to integrate all these different thousands or millions of modules which are doing their work. But I think you have good starting points, no? Vision, language, memory, planning, reinforcement learning, and so on. And if you look at the brain, it gives you sort of a nice framework of what you might want to end up with. No? So I think yes, maybe not like one-to-one that you copy some circuitry or something like that, but for us it was confirming that oh, maybe the brain is doing similar stuff we are doing, so that's interesting. And the other way around, I think it's also interesting. Of course, they are working typically quite differently, not so much with mathematical models. I think it's a very nice area, and they have made a lot of progress in the last 20 years or so. And they have their own methodologies, which is definitely sound. Of course, there's little agreement on a lot of things, or everybody has its own view and focuses on a very particular area or cognitive function. But I think it's very interesting work, and when I was reading up on this, I thought that's really nice, and they're really doing very good work. And of course, there is this transition of, like, for example, Bayesian brain, probably was mentioned before, and other things where they benefit from mathematical modeling. And I gave this similar presentation, and some people, I mean, for example, Edmund Rolls gave me positive feedback. He's one of the big guys studying the hippocampus. But of course, it's also a little bit of an uphill battle. They will not just say, oh, great, another theory. Fantastic. So there, on the right side, you see a mapping maybe from the more cognitive faculties to the technical factories, task event processing, for example, context memory, prediction planning, and so on. So we have if you want to read on this, we have a extended sort of tech report based on a NIPS workshop paper, and this year we also got a paper accepted at ESWC. Thanks a lot for your interest, and If you did something else, it's also okay.
Questions for Volk? Bernard.
You were saying that semantic memory may be just maybe obtained by simply factorizing out time from episodic memories. That seems to be a little bit too simple. I guess people working in semantic memory might say that there are other things involved, and maybe the
judgments are not
trivial inferences based on earlier episodic memories, and not just a marginalization. Or what's your feeling about that?
It's marginalization, it's not factoring. Yeah, okay, exactly. It's an integration step. It works quite nicely with the assumption people make in the semantic web community, where you only have positive facts. So once you discover something is true, it will be true forever. Of course, in reality, you want to override it. For example, Obama is not president anymore, these type of things. My view would be that this is a basic building block, and more other inference mechanisms work on top, more logical parts, for example. So there's not one theory explaining all, and this is maybe just one layer of explanation of some things. So, sure. But I mean, we do some reasoning, no? I mean, this inductive reasoning. Of course, that can also be dangerous. You can overgeneralize and have false memories, which is a big problem in witnesses, court witnesses, and so on. So a little bit we might be able to explain that. But in a way, I think episodes seem to be like images you remember or events you remember. Episodes or maybe facts derived from this episodic experience. Then you can do something called materialization also on the logical level, that if you have, for example, if you're in the semantic web community, one way to deal with reasoning is to just derive everything you can derive and put it into your database, and then querying becomes fast again. Because if you do all this reasoning online, it becomes very slow. So maybe this type of materialization is also happening somewhere in the brain based on other mechanisms, more based on logical concepts. It might be also that logic concepts are really in different parts of the brain and just use all these representations. A lot of interesting questions.
If a semantic memory is marginalization of episodic memory, then that would predict that if you can't form episodic memory, new episodic memories, then you can't form new semantic memories. Is there also a disease where you can form new episodic memories, but then you can't do the marginalization? So you learn lots and lots of new facts, but you never integrate them.
The people who have these problems with hippocampus, they memorize something for a minute or so, and then they completely lose it. I mean, there's a way to long-term memory. So they don't lose the ability to learn new skills, for example. If it doesn't have to go through the episodic memory, they're still able to learn things. But if it has to go through this more explicit experience, then they can only remember it for a minute or so. So if there's a famous video, like a wife comes in and the person greets her warmly, and then she goes out, and 2 minutes later she comes back and he completely forgot that she was just there. But this person functions otherwise completely normal, right? Can play piano and so on, and can talk about older memories. And this debate is definitely ongoing, and there are probably a lot of different opinions. Some people argue that how much is this consolidation going on? How much is the hippocampus still needed after the consolidation? There's a lot of discussion ongoing. Interestingly, this is the famous case HM, which was the first guy who had both Bukampi and associated areas removed. And there was the first evidence that there is really localization in the brain. And before there was still a big debate if all is a big hologram, and just by having this patient, people could recognize that there are really the special functionalities at special locations. Of course, also this debate is always going on even today. I think currently there's some articles that we should go away from the locality again and think of it more as a global system. I'm not sure if it's a really a contradiction, so I think it's very interesting to read about it and to learn what people's opinions are and where they all agree and where they sort of disagree.
Okay, if there's no further questions, if we could just thank all. Ah, here we have that. Okay.
So I'm just trying to get my mind around what the difference is between memory and pattern recognition. I mean, in a sense, in the pattern recognition that we saw in the previous talk, you maximize the likelihood, and we're all very well familiar with this. And now in this memory setting, it seems something different, right? Because it only makes sense to memorize something if there is something to predict, right? If you have a completely stochastic world where there is no possibility to predict, it doesn't make sense to memorize anything because you cannot do anything with that functionally, right? So it is the amount of memory that you will build up in a system is proportional to the amount of predictability of the environment, essentially. So that would say that that actually memory and pattern recognition are very different, because the one memory is about temporal evolution, and pattern recognition is maybe not. So can you comment on that?
We are thinking of some mechanisms a neural network might have developed episodic and semantic memory. No? For example, I think a very simple animal with a small neural network, and it's light and dark and whatever, at some point it might want to store more specific information. Of course, you can build a neural network much larger, or you build something like a pattern, I mean pattern memory, no? Like, oh, I've seen this episode before and I should probably do this. So it's almost like a template or a you remember. So that might become so you recognize, or if I drive home, I always I'm this corner and this, I always have to do this, and then I remember another episode, I have to always do this. So I think there's a good maybe reasoning from a biological point of view why you would develop something like episodic memory, remembering specific episodes, not just a general pattern predictor, but adding some specific memories. And then at some point, biology might want to develop a concept of things. I mean, classes, I think, are the simplest, maybe, semantic level things, you know, that there's a dog or a tiger or so on. And then in the next step, you might want to have a more explicit description of the scene. And so I think there's a smooth transition from pure pattern recognition to memory systems. Also, our system, I mean, of course, if we have labels, if we have SPO labels for a given scene, it's basically supervised learning what we can do. So it's, there's also a link there. No? Of course, in the brain, you don't assume this type of supervised learning is going on, so that's a completely different issue. So it's not that far away. No? I mean, also the knowledge graph model, I always drew it as a predictive model. No? Always. So you see this predictive modules everywhere, I think. No? Of course, the coupling is because they have common latent representations, so there's sharing of information. But so I think I think biology would have motivation to develop these things pretty early on, maybe. You know? So just remember, in this situation, I should do something special, and not what my stupid pattern recognition system tells me to, or whatever, because I recognize the scene.
Great. So we could just thank Volker again for very interesting.